So let us start with the Enterobacteriaceae family. The Enterobacteriaceae family, it is characterized by 9 features. They are gram-negative, bacilli. They are non-capsulated or capsulated. They could be motile or non-motile. But if they are motile, they are usually motile by peritrichate flagella. That is flagella all around the bacteria. They are usually facultative anaerobes and aerobes. They are non-fastidious. That means they will grow readily on ordinary media like nutrient agar and McConkie agar. They ferment glucose, producing acid and gas, and sometimes only acid. They all reduce nitrates, but the important is the last two characteristic. That's how biochemically we identify that it is Enterobacteriaceae, that they are all catalase positive and oxidase negative. The old classification was focused on lactose fermentation, mainly based on McConkie medium. So some of them will ferment lactose and give you pink color colonies on McConkie agar. The classical example was E. coli and Klebsiella, and some of them, they do not ferment the lactose. So they produce colorless colonies on McConkie agar, and that is Salmonella and Shigella. And some of them, they do ferment lactose, but on a longer period of time. So they are late lactose fermenters. The classical example is Shigella soni. But now we have a DNA based classification in which we have divided them into tribes. And each tribe has a combination of bacteria. For example, Escherichia, Salmonella and Shigella belong to tribe 1. Klebsiella, Enterobacter, Serratia belong to tribe 2. Proteus family, that is Proteus Morganella, Providentia, they belong to tribe 3. Arvinia belong to tribe 4. And Yersinia group of bacteria, they belong to Yersinia, that is 1. So let us start with the important ones in this group. We will discuss the first bacteria is Escherichia coli. It is usually a harmless commensal in the human intestine, and sometimes it is one of the most common pathogen encountered clinically. It causes mainly urinary tract infection, diarrhea, septicemia, meningitis, and pyogenic infection. So the UTI causing E. coli, they are known as UPEC, that is uropathogenic E. coli, and they bind to the P receptors, especially on uroepithelial cells, and they are the most common cause of UTI in all age groups in community setting. The diarrhea causing UTI, you can divide them into 5 different types, that is EPEC, ETEC, EIEC, EHEC, and EAEC. The EPEC stands for enteropathogenic E. coli, and it causes pediatric diarrhea. And that is basically, it goes and attaches to the microvilli of intestine and disrupts its function or destroy the microvilli, that is known as effacing lesions. ETEC, that is enterotoxigenic E. coli, that causes traveler's diarrhea, and it causes by producing 2 toxins, labile toxin and stable toxin. The labile toxin, it is increasing the cyclic AMP level, which draws the fluids and electrolytes out of the cells into the lumen. And stable toxin, it increases the cyclic GMP level, and it has also the same kind of effect. Enteroinvasive E. coli or EIEC causes invasive diarrhea, like Shigella, and it causes dysentery or bloody diarrhea. EHEC, that is enterohemorrhagic E. coli, it causes again bloody diarrhea, and main thing is hemorrhagic colitis. It produces a toxin known as verocytotoxin, and that is responsible for this. And due to that, there is another condition which is also associated with it, that is HUS, that is hemolytic uremic syndrome. Finally, we have enteroaggregative E. coli, and it causes usually the persistent diarrhea. The other infections are basically abdominal and pelvic infections, pneumonia, neonatal meningitis. The worldwide most common cause of neonatal meningitis is group B streptococci, but in India and worldwide, second most common cause is Escherichia coli. Apart from that, it also causes various wound and soft tissue infection like cellulitis and ulcer, especially in diabetic foot. So for UTI diagnosis, the sample should be collected is midstream urine. for transportation, if delay is more than 2 hours, then we should refrigerate the sample at 228 degree. On direct microscopy, you will see motile bacteria, which are gram-negative bacilli on gram staining. Semi-quantitative culture is required because we want to count the colonies, and that will give us an idea about how much bacteria are there per ml of urine. And why this is important, because that will sometime very important for interpretation of significant bacteriuria. So if it is more than 1 lakh bacteria per ml, we consider it a significant bacteriuria, and that indicates active infection. If it is less than 10,000, it is not significant and it represents the contamination. If it is in between, then ideally you should repeat the culture. But this is not absolute guidelines. It is much more detailed, and there are variations in this. So that means with lower count also, if a person is symptomatic or is on antibiotic therapy, we still consider it as symptomatic. Staphylococcus aureus, even a single colony is significant. So when you grow them on nutrient agar, it will grow. On Meconcia agar, lactose fermenting pink colonies will be there. Antibiotic sensitivity is required because these bacteria are multi-drug resistant now. And sometimes carbapenem, amikacin, or beta-lactam inhibitor combinations are required to treat them. So that was about E. coli. Now we are going to learn about the second enterobacteriaceae, that is Klebsiella pneumoniae. It again causes urinary tract infection, pneumonia, meningitis, septicemia, pyogenic infection. So all infections which E. coli can do, Klebsiella can do, except diarrhea. It is not a common cause of diarrhea. They are non-motile, capsulated, and produce mucoid colonies. The other Klebsiella species include Klebsiella granulomatis. It causes an ulcerative disease known as granuloma inguinale, and it is a sexually transmitted disease. The other two varieties, Klebsiella rhinosclerosis and Klebsiella ozonii, they affect the nasal cavity. The first one causes rhinoscleroma, that is potato-like tumor on the nose, and ozonii is causing atrophic rhinitis, where person loses the sense of smell due to atrophic nasal mucosa. Then the third enterobacteriaceae we deal today is Shigella. Shigella, it is the cause of bacillary dysentery. Dysentery is basically passage of loose stool mixed with blood and mucus. There are four important species of Shigella: Shigella dysentery, Flexneri, Boidi, and Soni. The minimum infective dose is very less for Shigella. It is 10 to 100 bacilli are sufficient to cause the infection and disease. And it is usually happen by ingestion through contaminated fingers. Risk factors are overcrowding, poor hygiene, and children less than 5 years. Why it causes this bloody diarrhea? It causes invasion, very similar to enteroinvasive E. coli, and both EIEC and Shigella has this virulence marker antigen, which is responsible for invasiveness. It is a protein, and it is coded by a plasmid. And how we can demonstrate this invasiveness in cell culture? We show that bacteria is able to invade the cells, mainly HAP2 and HeLa cells. Other test is you can detect this VMA protein with help of ELISA and other serological test. So bacilli infect the epithelial cell of large intestine, multiply inside and spread laterally, invade it, causes inflammation and thrombosis, which lead to necrosis and bloody diarrhea, that is dysentery. Again, stool sample is collected and we put it into enrichment liquid medium, that is selenite broth. And then it's sent to lab and it is plated mainly on selective media like deoxycholate citrate agar and xylosylicin deoxycholate agar, apart from the routine culture media, that is nutrient agar and Meconcia agar. And then it will be identified using the appropriate biochemical reactions. Treatment, it is fluid replacement for diarrhea, Antimicrobial treatment is usually not indicated in dysentery unless and until it is very severe, because it is thought that antibiotics may increase the severity of disease. That's why it is reserved only for extremes of ages and debilitated patients. Salmonella, that is the fourth bacteria in Enterobacteriaceae, which is very important. It is classified into typhoidal and non-typhoidal serotypes. Typhoidal Salmonella, we can see that there are four: Salmonella typhi and Salmonella paratyphi A, B, and C. They are exclusively human infection and they cause enteric fever. The Salmonella typhi causes typhoid fever and paratyphi causes paratyphoid fever. The typhoid fever is more severe in nature. Paratyphoid is little bit milder. Non-typhoidal Salmonella, they colonize the intestine and they are usually involved in gastroenteritis, food poisoning and sometimes septicemia. The most important thing is enteric fever, which is caused by Salmonella typhi and paratyphi. It is transmitted by ingestion of contaminated water and food. The infective dose is much higher. If you have seen, the Shigella has minimum infective dose, that is 10 to 100 bacilli. Here it is 10,000 to 10 lakh bacilli are required to establish the infection. They survive the gastric acidity, they penetrate the intestinal mucosa and they have capacity to enter into blood circulation. That's why they can cause septicemia. That's why we fear, because it is the diarrheal illness which can end up in septicemia. So the presentation is usually fever, which is tap letter, that is continuously increasing fever, headache, chills, rashes like rose spots, hepatosplenomegaly, relative bradycardia, that is low pulse rate than expected as per increase with temperature. Laboratory diagnosis, mainly I remember BASU for this. B stands for blood culture, A stands for agglutination test, that is Vidal test, S and U was for stool and urine culture. And in first week of illness, it is blood culture. In second week onwards, it is agglutination test, that is Vidal test. And stool and urine are useful in third and fourth week. So blood culture can be done with conventional or automated blood culture system. Vidal test has to be done second week onwards. You have already learned Vidal test in your serological reaction, so now I'm not going into detail about its interpretation and other things. Treatment, it is other antibiotics are usually resistant now. It is treated with third generation cephalosporin, that is ceftriaxone. So Vidal test, it is ordered after second week and third week. It is also useful. So titer will depend on stage of disease. Every area has its endemic titer. For example, in Ahmedabad, the titer antibody that we consider is 1:80. If it is more than 1:80, then we consider it significant. But in Vidal test, it is important to show the rise of titer. That's why usually paired sample is required. One, when patient presents to, and second, 1 week after. And if the titer increases, that indicates that there is actually an active infection. The titer for O is usually more than 100 and H is usually more than 200. False positive Vidal test can happen in previously infected patients or person who has taken vaccine. So sometimes there is an anamnestic response, that means some other illness or pregnancy or some unrelated condition may increase the overall antibody titer, including the typhoidal antibody, and that will give you this false positive Vidal test. But how to differentiate it? You repeat the Vidal test after 1 week and the titer will not show rise. It will either remain as it is or it will decrease. So that was the four important bacteria in Enterobacteriaceae group, that is E. coli, Klebsiella, Shigella and Salmonella. They are very important for exam. Now let us see other members of Enterobacteriaceae. Enterobacteria is very similar to Klebsiella, but it is motile. Klebsiella is non-motile. It has two bacteria in it, aerogens and cloacae, and they are usually isolated from all type of clinical specimens. Then the third group is Proteus, group of bacteria, that is Proteus, Morganella and Providentia. They all causes opportunistic infection like UTI, wound infection, septicemia. The non-motile strains of Proteus is usually motile. okay, by peritrichate flagella. But there are certain strains of protease which are non-motile, and we utilize these strains to detect antibodies against rickettsia, which is a cause of typhus fever, and this is known as Welfalex reaction. This is your short question. Serratia marcescens, it is a highly resistant bacteria against most of the antibiotics, and it is characterized by a red color non-diffusible pigment. So you can see this red color pigment on its colony, and that pigment's name is prodigiosin. Okay. Then Yersinia pestis, it is basically causes a zoonotic disease known as plague, and it is transmitted from rodents, and it requires a rat flea, arthropod vector, for this transmission. And we have in India the epidemic in Surat in 1994. Yersinia pestis presents with three forms. Bubonic form, that is the most common form. It is characterized by enlarged and tender regional lymph nodes, mainly inguinal lymph nodes, which is known as bubo. Then it can cause pneumonic, that is pneumonia-like presentation and septicemia-like presentation. So it starts with bubonic plague when flea bites, usually on legs. Then it causes inguinal lymph node, which may show gangrene and cutaneous hemorrhages, and case fatality is 30-90%. Then it may spread by droplet infection to other person, and it causes pneumonia in them, or it can spray secondary to bubonic infection in the same person, it can cause pneumonic plague. It is invariably fatal unless treated. And septicemic plague, it is terminal event in both bubonic and pneumonic plague. The other members of Yersinia pestis category, that is other Yersinia species, is Yersinia enterocolitica and Yersinia pseudotuberculosis. And disease caused by both of them is known as Yersiniosis. They are enteropathogenic, and they usually causes gastroenteritis, terminal ileitis, and mesenteric lymphadenopathy. So that finishes the Enterobacteriaceae group. Now we are going to discuss non-Enterobacteriaceae gram-negative bacilli. In them, the most important one is Vibrio species. We can divide Vibrio species into two categories, non-halophilic and halophilic. Non-halophilic means they do not love salt. And halophilic means they love salt. That means they can tolerate higher concentration of sodium chloride. So non-halophilic are the two bacteria, Vibrio cholerae and Vibrio mimicus. In halophilic, there are three bacteria, Parahemolyticus, Alginolyticus, and Vulnificus. So Vibrio cholerae, it is the causative agent of cholera. It is basically a watery diarrhea, and it has caused till now 7 pandemics. And out of which first 6 were started in India. We can classify these Vibrio groups into two categories, that is Vibrio cholerae group A and group B, and that is based on their H antigenic structure. H means flagella. Vibrio cholerae, it is highly motile bacteria. It is actually the fastest bacteria, and it is having only single flagella. So that flagellar antigen, if it is same in all the Vibrio group, that is group A. If it is different biochemically and antigenically, all of them are put in group B. Group A are further subdivided based on its O antigenic subgroup, whether they are having O1 or they are not having O1. So O1 and non-O1. Non-O1 has O23, O22, O139. O1 is further divided into two biotypes, that is classical and Altor, and each of them are further divided based on O antigen composition into three serotype, Ogawa, Inaba, and Hikojima. Vibrio cholerae are very delicate bacteria. They cannot survive gastric acidity like Salmonella. So it is required that person who are achlorhydric, they are more susceptible to cholera. That allow it to reach to small intestine. While it reaches the intestinal epithelial cell by crossing the mucus barrier, attaches it with a pili known as TCP, toxin coordinated virus. And along with this pili expression, there is a toxin released, which is known as cholera toxin. The cholera toxin is actually, as shown in diagram, has 5 binding subunit and 1 active subunit. These five binding subunits binds with the GM1 receptor on intestinal epithelial cell. It goes inside, and then active subunit, it is activate the adenyl cyclase, which forms cyclic AMP, and it will throw fluid and electrolytes into the lumen, and that is the responsible cause of watery diarrhea. And it is painless watery diarrhea. The typical appearance is known as rice watery stool, and it is very severe profuse diarrhea. Earlier, when there is pandemic, such type of beds has to be put, because there is constant rippling of stool from the patient, and severe dehydration can happen, which can end up in renal failure. Laboratory diagnosis, obviously stool culture microscopy is required, and stool microscopy on hanging drop directly will show dieting motility, because bacteria are very actively motile. And yellow color colony on TCBS and other biochemical reactions will identify it. For treatment, obviously the fluid replacement is the mainstay of treatment, either oral or IV fluid depending on the severity. Antibiotics can be given in severely dehydrated patients. Now, other Vibrio species, which are halophilic Vibrio, includes parahemolyticus, alginolyticus, and vulnificus. They cause intestinal and extraintestinal manifestation. Because these three species, they are halophilic, they are found in seawater. So, they usually cause food poisoning or diarrhea after consumption of seafood, or they show wound infection after wound contamination with seawater. Then we have non-fermenting gram-negative bacilli. Here, they do not ferment any carbohydrates. Now, you know that glucose utilization or carbohydrate utilization can happen by two ways, either aerobically or anaerobically. Anaerobic is known as fermentation. And if they utilize aerobically or oxidatively, we call them as non-fermenting GNB. And in this group, the important ones are Pseudomonas aeruginosa, Acinetobacter, and Burkholderia species. So let us tackle them. Pseudomonas aeruginosa, it is major pathogenic species, and it is mainly involved in healthcare associated infection, and especially in cystic fibrosis patients. So this bacteria has ability that it is resistant to disinfectant, antiseptics, as well as most of the antibiotics. And it produces various virulence factor, including capsule, biofilm, various toxin. It releases four colored pigments, pyoverdine, pyocyanin, fluorescein, right? And these pigments gives you a colored colony, and it is a diffusible pigment. Entire plate will turn either green or blue depending on the pigments produced. It produces various clinical manifestation, starting from wound infection to pneumonia to septicemia. Anything can be caused by Pseudomonas aeruginosa. It is oxidase positive. It is pigment producing. Blue-green diffusible pigment is usually produced, and it is non-fermenting GNB. And it is motile bacteria. It is actively motile bacteria with polar flagella. Treatment. You have to choose an antibiotic which has a specific anti-pseudomonal action. For example, in ceftazidime, piperacillin, or carbapenem are usually the preferred therapeutic option. And it is multi-drug resistant. It can acquire resistance easily. Then the second bacteria is Acinetobacter species. They are saprophytic. They are found everywhere in the environment. And they are also a very common cause of healthcare-associated infection, especially if you are immunosuppressed. And Burkholderia species, again, they are present in hospital environment, and they are very common contaminants of IV fluids, and they cause fatal respiratory infections, septicemia in hospitalized patient, especially in immunosuppressed cases. Then you have Burkholderia pseudomallei. It causes malidosis. It ranges from acute localized to pulmonary infection, septicemia. It is a bipolar strain bacteria on gram staining, so safety pin appearance is there. The characteristic is that it is intrinsically resistant to polymyxin B. That means most of the bacteria, gram negative bacteria, when none of the antibiotic works, they are usually sensitive to polymyxin and colistin. But Burkholderia species, it is intrinsically resistant to polymyxin B. That's why treatment of choice is basically cotrimoxazole. If that is not working, then meropenem and ceftazidime. then there is fastidious gram-negative bacilli. The bacteria that we have seen so far, they are all non-fastidious bacteria. That means they will grow on routine culture media like nutrient agar and McConkie agar. But now we are going to talk about fastidious gram-negative bacilli, which will only grow on blood agar. They require either blood, serum or egg. So they will grow on blood agar, chocolate agar or some kind of serum or egg containing media is required. So here there are three bacteria which are important to discuss, that is Haemophilus, Bordetella and Brucella. Among Haemophilus species, the most pathogenic one is Haemophilus influenzae. It is cause of pneumonia and meningitis, especially in children. It can grow on blood agar adjacent to Staphylococcus aureus streak. So the colonies near Staphylococcus aureus will be larger. As you go away from that streak, the colonies will become smaller. This is because this bacteria is dependent on two factors, factor X and factor V, and these two factors are present inside the RBC. And Staphylococcus aureus will lyse the RBC and release these factors. And so the colony near Staphylococcus aureus are bigger because the nutrition is much higher there. And this phenomenon is known as satellitism. And this is very important from your exam point of view. It is frequently asked as a short question. Meningitis, as you know, that it is an age group related clinical diagnosis has to be put. For example, neonatal meningitis, we know now that group B streptococcus and E. coli are the common causes. Childhood meningitis is usually caused by Haemophilus influenza. Neisseria meningitis is a common cause in adults and young children. Right? The treatment of choice for Haemophilus influenza is ceftriaxone, and the incidence has decreased after vaccination has started with its HIV conjugate vaccine. You know, there is a general thumb rule that any bacteria which has a capsule, capsule inhibits phagocytosis, and that lead to ability of bacteria to enter into bloodstream. So all capsulated bacteria, they usually inhibit phagocytosis and enter blood, so cause bacteremia, and they are the usual ones which usually cause the meningitis. So Haemophilus influenza capsular vaccine is available, and there are 6 serotypes, out of which type B is more virulent. That's why vaccine is given mainly against it. The another Haemophilus is Haemophilus Ducri. It causes a painful ulcer on genitals, that is known as chancroid or soft chancre. It is sexually transmitted disease, and it also causes painful inguinal lymphadenopathy. Then there are Hazekrupp, that is H-A-C-E-K. H stands for Haemophilus species, A stands for Aggregatobacter species, C for Cardiobacterium, E for Echinella corridens, and K for Kingella kingi. What is the significance of this bacteria? They are usually normal oral flora, and whenever you do any kind of invasive dental procedures or whenever there is breach in mucosa of oral cavity, these bacteria gain access to the bloodstream, and then they cause serious infection like endocarditis, and treatment is difficult and it requires very prolonged duration therapy. Then Bordetella. In Bordetella we have one species known as Bordetella pertussis, which is a common cause of whooping cough, and it is highly contagious. It is toxin mediated disease. It produces a toxin known as pertussis toxin, and the cough has a characteristic paroxysmal cough. It is disease is divided into 3 stages: catarrhal stage, then paroxysmal stage, and finally the recovering stage. And then there is Brucella species. It usually causes zoonotic febrile illness. It is also common cause of PU, that is pyrexia of unknown origin, mainly in farmers in India. And it can be detected by blood culture or antibody detection by a standard agglutination test. Treatment of choice is doxycycline. Then there are miscellaneous gram-negative bacilli. In this group is Campylobacter. Campylobacter jejuni, which is a common cause of diarrhea, pain and fever. It is gram-negative rod, and it can be grown under microaerophilic condition. This microaerophilic bacteria are very less. Sometimes in short patients, they ask what are the examples of microaerophilic bacteria. So Campylobacter is one of them. Then you have Helicobacter pylori. Now, Helicobacter pylori, it is a gram-negative covered rod, just like Campylobacter, but it colonizes stomach, gastric epithelial lining, and it is involved in pathogenesis of acute gastritis, peptic ulcer disease, and carcinoma. So, this is very important bacteria, and sometimes this is asked as a short question. It can be diagnosed by urea breath test and biopsy urea test. This is the bacteria which gives urea taste fastest. Okay. And that's why it is chosen as a diagnostic modality. Treatment, it is usually treated with a proton pump inhibitor and combination of two antibiotics. So the common therapy is triple drug regime, that is omeprazole, clarithromycin and metronidazole for 7 to 14 days. There are other regimes also that you will learn in pharmacology. Then the bacteria is Legionella. Legionella, out of that, the most pathogenic species is Legionella pneumophila. Again, it is fastidious, gram-negative short rod, and it is associated with two diseases, a milder flu-like illness, which is known as Pontic fever, and a very severe illness, which involves interstitial pneumonia or atypical pneumonia, that is known as Legionnaires' disease. You can grow this bacteria under a selective medium, that is frequently asked as a short question, that is BYCE agar, that is buffered charcoal yeast extract agar. And you can also detect a faster method is that rapid antigen detection in urine, that is possible. It is sensitive to macrolides, and that's why they are the, especially azithromycin is the antibiotic of choice. The characteristic of Legionella is that it grows in collected water system, right? And that's why where air conditions or water coolers are there, it is a common cause of pneumonia. Then there is Gardnerella vaginalis. It causes profuse watery vaginal discharge, that is known as bacterial vaginosis. This bacteria will show that it attaches to the vaginal epithelial cells, and that is known as clue cells. So that is again your short question. Then there is Streptobacillus moniliformis. It causes zoonotic systemic illness transmitted by rodents, that is known as rat bite fever. Another bacteria will also cause this condition, that is Spirillum minus. Last time we have seen in gram-positive bacteria, anaerobic bacteria known as Clostridium. Same way today we are going to discuss about other anaerobic bacteria. Clostridium was the spore-forming anaerobe. Now today we are going to discuss about non-sporing anaerobes. Most of them are normal flora of mouth, gastrointestinal tract and genital tract. And they are recognized as an important cause of human infection. Out of which I would like to focus more on Bacteroides fragilis. It is the most common commensal in human intestine, and it is actually the most common anaerobe which is isolated from clinical specimen. And this bacteria, it is a common cause of abscesses, mainly brain abscess it is implicated, and other infection also it can do. Now, what are the other miscellaneous bacterial infection? So here we have finished gram-negative bacteria. Now we are discussing other bacterial infections which are spirochetes. Spirochetes is basically spiral shaped bacteria which are very thin, flexible, and it includes mainly three groups, that is Treponema, Borrelia and Leptospira. And this is one of the group in which bacteria are motile, but they do not have flagella. Actually flagella is there, but it is inside the bacterium, and you cannot see it outside the bacterium. It is situated between outer membrane and cell wall. So there are many spirochetes, but as I already told you, three human pathogenic genuses are Treponema, Borrelia and Leptospira. Treponema pallidum, it is a causative agent of a sexually transmitted disease that is known as syphilis. And syphilis has mainly four stages: primary syphilis, secondary syphilis, latent syphilis and late or tertiary syphilis. So what happens in primary syphilis? In primary syphilis, the genital ulcer is there, but characteristic feature is that it is a painless ulcer. and there is painless lymphadenopathy, and that differentiate it from rest of the genital ulcers. The ulcer will heal even if you don't treat it within 10 to 40 days, but it will allow the multiplication of bacteria and dissemination via blood. And then it will present with secondary syphilis, which usually involves skin and mucosa. So skin rashes and mucosal patches like condylomata will be seen. That will heal over 4 to 5 years, or it may cause serious involvement of eyes, bones and meninges. So this is a typical syphilitic ulcer on tongue. This is secondary syphilis showing you the rashes. Now here I would like to draw attention that there are rashes on palms and soles. Very few diseases can cause palm or plantar rash. So if you see rashes on palms and soles, always put syphilis as one of your differential diagnoses. Then there is a latent syphilis which does not show any kind of symptoms, and then immune mediated complication will take over and it causes tertiary syphilis, which involves heart and vascular system and brain and spinal cord. So cardiovascular syphilis is manifested as aneurysm or gamete on heart, and quaternary syphilis that will affect spinal cord in form of tapes dorsalis or brain in form of general paralysis of insane. Syphilis bacteria, that is Treponema pallidum, can transmit vertically, that is from mother to fetus, and it can cause congenital syphilis. So early syphilis and late syphilis. Early syphilis manifests less than 2 years. It could be asymptomatic, or if it is symptomatic, it will be date born fetus, or it will show pemphigus syphiliticus, that is premature baby. You will see bone abnormality, bullous lesion on skin and pneumonia. If it is manifesting late, then you will see a triad that is known as Hutchison triad, which is manifested by sensory neural deafness, interstitial keratitis and Hutchison teeth. Apart from that, various deformity like saddle nose, ectropion, that is eversion of eyelid, snuffles will be seen. So for example, this is the bullous lesion in early congenital syphilis. This is the typical Hutchison teeth, where you can see centrally notched central incisor. Then saddle nose and ectropion, then snuffles, that is basically syphilitic rhinitis, and often involves bloody rhinorrhea. So diagnosis, for example, if you want to detect primary syphilis, that is the ulcer, then you take a swab or you could take a collection of exudate from that ulcer and examine it under dark ground microscopy, and that will show you the motile spirochetes. For secondary syphilis, I would recommend that you should go for a antibody detection, that is cardiolipin antibodies. That is basically non-specific antibody detection. It is a screening test, that is VDRL or RPR. RPR is more preferable compared to VDR. You have learned about this in serological reactions. And then you have to confirm your positive results of VDRL or RPR with TPHA, that is a specific antibody detection test against Treponema pallidum. Treatment, penicillin is still the drug of choice for all stages of syphilis, and people who are allergic to penicillin should be given doxycycline. Then there are certain non-treponemal species which causes more or less similar disease to syphilis, but with little difference here and there, and they are usually milder versions. For example, Treponema pertuni causes yaws, Endemicum causes endemic syphilis, and Cartium causes pinta. Then the second spirochete is Borrelia. It causes various diseases depending on species. They are usually commensal of buccal and genital mucosa. There are three main pathogenic species that I would like to emphasize. That is Borrelia recurrentis, causes lapsing fever, recurrent fever. Borrelia burgdorferi, which is causes Lyme disease, which is a tick-borne illness, and Borrelia vincenti, which causes Vincent's angina, basically submandibular gland infection, along with some other fusiform bacilli. The third spirochete is Leptospira introgens. It causes leptospirosis, which is zoonotic disease. It spreads by direct contact with urine of infected animals, mainly rat. I remember R3 for Leptospira. Rat, rice fields and rainwater. When rainwater fills the rice fields, the farmers, they usually do not wear shoes and they go to fields where water is collected, and they come into contact with rodent urine, and that's how they acquire Leptospira. There are two types of illnesses. Majority is mild illness, 90% of them, but 10% they have liver and kidney involvement along with hemorrhages. So hepatorenal hemorrhagic syndrome, that is known as Wales disease. You can detect this bacteria with the diagram microscopy of blood and CSF. You can even try culture on specialized medium known as EMGH, that is Ellingsen, McLaw, Johnson-Harris medium. But the easiest way to detect this is by serology using MAT test, that is microscopic agglutination test, and that is the gold standard. Treatment, doxycycline is the treatment of choice for mild cases. If it is severe, we can try penicillin. So that finished spirochetes. Now we are talking about rickettsia. Now rickettsia comprises of two genera, rickettsia and oreinsia. They are obligate intracellular organism. You cannot grow them in artificial media. They are transmitted always by some arthropod vector, that is tick, mite, flea or louse. So there are three genera, rickettsia, oreinsia, alligia. In oreinsia we have chigger-borne scrub typhus. In rickettsia group we have typhus group and spotted fever group. Typhus group, if it is louse born, it causes epidemic typhus or Brucellosis disease. If it is flea born, it causes endemic typhus. Mite born, rickettsial pox, and tick born, we have Rocky Mountain fever and tick typhus. Earlier, Coxsilla and Rocky Lima were included in rickettsia, but now they are not included because Coxsilla, which causes Q fever, it is not transmitted by any arthropod, and Rocky Lima quintana, which is a cause of trench fever, it can grow in cell-free media and it has a different genetic composition. So in exam they usually ask that which disease is caused by which species and which vector is involved. So this table is very beautifully given in your textbook, so I am not repeating this table here. You should refer to this, so because I have a whole range of bacteria to cover in two sessions, I am just skipping this portion and I leave it to you. Laboratory diagnosis, you can detect rickettsial antibody using Well-Felix test, or which is basically non-specific cross-agglutination test. I have told you earlier that protease non-motile stains are used to detect antibodies against rickettsia. You can also use specific antibody detection test using immunofluorescence or ELISA. Then comes the next group, that is Chlamydia. Chlamydia again obligate intracellular bacteria, and there are three main species to discuss, that is Trachomatis, Cetacea and Pneumoniae. The Chlamydia life cycle is important. This bacteria, it enters into the cell and it forms the elementary body, and then it multiplies and then it forms the reticulate body. So, and then it fills the cell and rupture and gets released. So this is very frequently asked, that what is the difference between elementary body and reticulate body. So how I remember is that elementary is extracellular, that means it is infectious, and reticulate body is replicative thing, so it remains inside and it fills the cells and it ruptures the cell. So we have three species to discuss: Trachomatis, Cetacea and Pneumoniae. Trachomatis has two biovar, that is trick agents and LGV. Trick agents have A to K varieties, in which ABC causing eye infection, that is trachoma. It is one kind of follicular conjunctivitis. And D to K can cause conjunctivitis, which is inclusion conjunctivitis. And it can also cause genital infections as well as pneumonia in infants. While LGV is L1, L2, L3 strains, and it causes a sexually transmitted disease known as lymphogranuloma vandrum. See, Cetacea, it is basically causes cetacosis, that is basically atypical interstitial pneumonia in people who are exposed to birds, mainly parrots, right? Chlamydia pneumoniae, it has only one serotype and it usually causes acute respiratory distress disease. Then we have Mycoplasma. Mycoplasma is very important because there are lots of short question which can come from it. It is the smallest bacteria. It is a bacteria which does not have cell wall. It is a bacteria, that's why it is resistant to all cell wall antibiotics like beta lactams. And it is the most common cause of primary atypical bacterial pneumonia. And you can detect it by detecting antibodies against it. You can also culture it. It gives you fried egg colonies. Macrolides are drug of choice. There are other urogenital mycoplasmas which causes non-gonococcal urethritis. So that finishes almost most of the bacteria. I have tried to cover all the saline features of each bacteria, but because I have to sum it up in two sessions, I have skipped here and there some things. So I hope that this session is helpful to all of you, and best of luck for exams. If anyone has any doubt, you can ask me in chat box. Otherwise, session is almost complete. Okay, so I think no one has any kind of doubt, and I'm concluding the session. Thank you.